Thank you very much. Love to be here. I think I've been chosen for this job because I am the most brilliant contestant on Pointless Celebrities that there's been so far. So I think that's the reason I've got this. We may have a discussion about that later to see if that's the case. But will you please welcome the men behind Pointless, Richard Osman and Alexander Armstrong, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome. Sit down. is that right that I'm the best? Best contestant ever on Pointless.
Certainly the highest score.
Yeah. That's true. I've just answered one question.
Yeah.
Getting 100 is the...
You got knocked out in round one. You're coming back though, aren't you?
I am coming back. I'm doing another one this time round.
Who did you come on with?
I came on Dom Jolly.
No.
I know. Dom Jolly won. Oh, he's my name. I don't like Dom Jolly as it is. He not only won, but he actually got a pointless answer in the final.
Oh, that is
so. My chance. He didn't even get any of the money shared out. It was the worst possible result.
Yeah.
And I was on with Rona Cameron. I was slightly forced into trying to make a low answer, but if I had my time again, never mind. Exactly. It's not about me. I'll be on again, and I might be on with Robert Webb next time. So he's clever,
good.
Right?
Yeah, he's good.
That's gonna be.
If you mess up that time, it's really your fault.
It is. So let's talk about Pointless before we get on to the book. What are the origins of Pointless? How did this show come about?
Well, you know, I have been a TV producer for many years. I'm not a TV presenter. I'm not a natural in front of camera.
Come on.
Some people may have spotted every now and again. And we came up with this show. It's called Pointless, and pitched it to the BBC like you always do. And whenever you pitch a show to the BBC, you play it through, essentially. So it's very hard to explain quiz shows. People's eyes glaze over. But as soon as you play them, people go, oh, yeah, I get it. And so I played the role of me. in that, and a guy called Tom Blake, one of our producers, played the role of Xander. Not well enough, it turns out. And at the end, they said, yeah, we'd love to buy it. It's a great show. Let's have it. They were trying to think of someone to be me. They immediately thought of Xander for the Xander role.
Yeah.
Because I think you talked about doing Countdown. You weren't going to do it, but
I wasn't going to do Countdown.
But they sort of thought, you know, you might like
it. I was in the running, wasn't I? Anyway, sorry. On you go.
That's all right.
That's okay.
So they said, well, we need someone who can do it a bit like Richard. And then someone at the BBC said, well, how about Richard? He's a bit like Richard, isn't he? Which I am. That's a showbiz exclusive. And so I said, yeah, I'll do it. It'll be a little short run thing. I'll do 20 episodes of this and tell the grandkids I did a quiz show. And now I'm Bob Holness.
Yeah.
Just 5 short years later.
It's incredible. I mean, the actual format itself, when I first saw it, I thought, oh, all they've done is they've taken Family Fortunes and turned it the other way up.
How dare you?
Yeah, yeah. Was that how it started? Because but actually, there's a lot more to it than that. I mean, it's a lot cleverer than that idea. But was the cleverness behind it deliberate? Did you think this is a fiendishly clever?
Well, it was an accident.
Or did you just think, we'll turn Family Fortunes upside down and by accident create this fiendish general knowledge?
No, I think that you need a big hook.
Yeah.
And that is quite a big hook coming up with the least popular answer. And we'd done a quiz show a few years before called Beat the Nation, where we asked every question to 100 people.
Right.
And that was the scoring system. So
what happened to Beat the Nation?
We did about 100 of them. It was Graham Garden and Timbert Taylor.
Brilliant.
I remember they said, Graham Garden said to me, we're like Ant and Dec, antique and decrepit. That was his, so we'd done that, so we had that scoring system, and then as soon as someone came up with the name Pointless, that's the key, suddenly it all kind of falls into place.
I guess every time a show fails, or perhaps doesn't get picked up, there'll be little good bits of DNA that you keep from it, and then you sort of put...
That's exactly it. If anyone's got a Land Rover, whenever they die, you always pick something out of the engine to use in your next Land Rover. And that's pretty much what we did.
That's what we're driving now.
But at least we're stealing from ourselves and that.
That's true.
Which is all right.
But it's sort of very clever the way it works, having played it as well, because you're put in an awful position in lots of different ways.
It's much harder being a celebrity as
well. But I think it's just a hard game because it's most... I'm good at general knowledge, but most general knowledge is about knowing the most obvious answer to nearly everything, and so you can bluff your way through. So it's very specific. But also you've then got to decide what you think other people will have said, which is the hard thing as well. And in the case of the one I couldn't do, there were so many things. It was 1980s number ones by solo artists. And you kind of think, well, did it get to number one? Was it in the 1980s?
Well, that's the thing. If you're good at quizzes, the edges of your knowledge, that's what you're testing all the time. And that's when none of us are any good. You know, we're all very good at the stuff we know.
Yeah.
We're all good at the stuff we don't know because we marry people who know it. But the stuff in the middle, where it's like, oh, I saw, yes, I know a bit about, yes, I know a little bit about this. And you think, well, do you? Do you, with a camera on, do you? And lights on you, do you know that? And when we meet all the people before the show, we always walk around and say hello to people. And the terror, it's proper terror in people's eyes.
Yeah.
But the real terror, the most terror, is in people who are really good quizzers. It's the people who are really clever, because they got the most to lose.
Yeah.
Because they know they're clever, and they know they want to show off. And this show, if you want to show off, sometimes that bites you.
It does. And it's brutal, because you get one question, and it's like you can sometimes just have one question.
Well, you
can come back. Yeah, you can come back.
The beauty of it, you come back.
Even on the regular version, you can have two questions and just be two things you don't know about, and you're off.
So yeah, I don't know what my tactics would ever be. People always say, will we play it? And the answer is probably no, because we've got so much to lose. But I'm not sure my tactics would probably just play a fairly safe...
Yeah.
Play it safe. Don't try and be dazzling. Don't go for pointless.
Well, definitely on the pointless celebrities version. Yeah. I mean, there's so many people mess up. I just can't... And it took me literally weeks to overcome my... I was more nervous on it than I was on Mastermind, which I was very...
Really?
Yeah, I was very nervous on Mastermind.
Yeah, but
I was
that's more good. That's good to hear.
But it was harder than Mastermind.
But if we were a pair, and at some point... I'm sure at some point it's bound to happen. We'll run out of ideas at some point, and we'll resort to that. The thing is, you would be solid as a rock. You'd know how to play it. I wouldn't... I would absolutely try and showboat.
Yes.
That's the problem. And you know, I suspect we'd get knocked out. We also, another show, we make £1 million drop, we do. And when we were developing that, we played it hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of times. You play it all the time. And so I played the £1 million drop more than anyone else in the world, I think. And I have never won a penny. And I never won a penny because I just go, a million, C. I think it's C, a million. And so every single time I lose it, I'd be an absolute liability. A bit of liability. I have lost in that game, I think I probably lost £78 million.
Wow. Really?
Something like that. And we play for real money at Endemol as well, so.
That's why they keep you working on this. I have to do so many episodes. And how did the two of you meet? Because you've known each other for quite a long
time. For ages. We were sort of 18, I think, weren't we, when we met?
So it's 7 years ago, is that?
Yeah. You've hardly changed, actually. I do feel like we're about to sing something, holding these mics out. And now perhaps is the moment.
We should do.
We
met at university many years ago.
Yeah.
Were you friends at university, or did you just passing acquaintances?
We knew each other a bit.
That's a no, isn't it?
We knew each other a bit. No, we became friends properly after university.
Yeah.
But, you know, as quite often you do, you know.
Yeah.
But no, we knew each other. We liked each other, right? It's fair to say.
Yeah. No, absolutely. So, we knew each other a bit. But, then after university, because Xander went into comedy... after a fashion.
Like the pause there.
And I was trying to think how to describe your career. So Xander went into comedy and I did as well, so I was behind the scenes in comedy. So we would bump into each other every now and again, which was nice, wasn't it? Nice to see a friendly face.
Yeah.
But it's been a lot. Yeah, we hadn't worked together for till
this.
This, really, have we?
Yeah, we nearly did.
Isn't that weird?
Yeah.
Seems to have worked out all right.
Yeah, it's worked out really well.
It's lovely. And what appealed about Pointless when the countdown didn't appeal to you?
Chiefly, a really, really good hook. I mean, like the show, you said, oh, that's good. I'd watch that. I'd have to watch that.
Yeah.
That's a show I couldn't walk away from. But the thing about Countdown is that they guard it very, you know, they curate that show.
Yeah.
And you pretty much have to do it as it's always been done. Whereas this, we had a completely free reign.
Yeah.
You know, and as Richard says, neither of us is any good as an actual host. You know what I mean? We're rubbish at that. But actually, we've sort of turned that into a bit of a virtue. So.
Well, that's true. But it's an amazing... It's a very great... It's a really work... A double works as a double act, the two of you. I mean, you look like you're having a lot of fun. Is that
definitely
just...
That,
is that because you just have to mess around to get through... You do four shows in a day, right, when you're recording.
We do, yeah.
So is it to keep it fun for yourselves, or is it... Or,
I think we just genuinely do. It's pretty fun as it is, actually. I mean, occasionally... It happens very, very occasionally. You have a show when you're... really just knackered. You kind of phone it in a bit. And even those shows are really, really good fun.
Yeah.
You phone it in sometimes.
That's not what I'm saying, but you know.
I have never in 800 episodes phoned it in. That is unbelievable.
You're right, you haven't. No, that's
there are the occasional shows where one of us is not quite up to snuff. And usually the other one carries the burden. You usually spot it, don't you, after a while. I think, Well, Zander hasn't said anything at all for the first 20 minutes. I wonder if I should ramp this up a little bit. Or if you don't. So, Richard, have you got anything about Peruvian mountains? No.
Nope.
Okay.
Yeah, that's what I think was so funny, because they always leave in the eggy pauses.
Yes.
Because there's a bit where I'm just thinking, I've got a really shit joke here I could make. I'm thinking, do I go all the way up that hill for a very small sandwich, or do I just move on? And I just think, now we'll get on with the show. But what's really funny is that they all get left in the edit.
But you also get those pauses where you'll say something like, "So, Richard, Joan of Arc," and we will, if you ever come to see a recording, which you do, so it's quite fun. We'll do 20 minutes. Of stuff about Joan of Arc, because I'll say something and a little sketch or something will occur to us, and then we'll go on and on and on and on, and we're really making ourselves laugh and the audience enjoying it. And you watch it on show, and you know, Zander goes, anything about Joan of Arc? I say, she died in 1851. Thank you, Richard. And you're back, and you think, that's not what happened.
Yeah.
They just turn the cameras off. They know you're going towards them. Let's not waste any.
You can almost tell sometimes when we're riffing that they've gone for a fag break.
And do you have any favourite sort of wrong answers that the contestants have given?
I tell you what, I've got a favourite right answer, actually. Yeah. It was in, must have been very early on, series two, which was words ending double Z.
Right.
We had these guys on. There's a guy with a fantastic big hat. And,
yeah.
And he just said, jizz. and it turns out, actually, jizz, as you all know, is the impression of an animal's movement just on the periphery of your
so you can just catch
vision.
You can catch the jizz of a dog just come on guys, this is how we're doing a vodcast here, people are going to watch this. You can catch the jizz of a dog just
in the corner of your eye
just there. Very difficult to get out, but you can do. But you know, so we did that, and you know, that's all left in because very early on in Pointless, in the first series, because you know the BBC, they want to see the format works. We had five pairs of contestants. It's very different.
Yeah.
There was no real banter, was there?
No, not
you know, it was literally.
We did lots of banter, but it never made it into the show.
Actually, that's the right way around. There was loads of banter, but none of it was edited in. For some, I don't understand why. We had five, lots of contestants. Went on for a long time, and actually from the second one, because we were enjoying it so much, we said, well, I think you, in fact,
said. We didn't have many cameras. That's the thing. Because in order to put all our guff that we come out with, you have to have cameras on us all the time, which we like. but in those days, obviously, the cameras were on other people, so it looked really slick. So you were just left with two pretty hopeless game show hosts and a very slick show, and lots of curious gaps. Anyway, we got rid of one of our lots of contestants. And now,
and then, you know, so something like jizz, say... In the first series, it probably wouldn't have landed anyway. You'd have said jizz, and we'd have gone, yes, it's the impression of an animal. But we could at least have a bit of fun with it from the second series onwards, because there's fewer contestants, and we were allowed to muck about. Yeah. I was literally watching a show before I came out today. It's a repeat. We had visual clues to star signs. Okay, so there was a goat, which was Capricorn, and all that kind of business, and an archer, which is Sagittarius. And then there's literally, there's always one very, very obvious one, and this one was a set of scales for Libra. So you think that's the one that, like, if you don't know any, go for that. And the two guys go, we're going to go for the set of scales, because, of course, where do you find scales? On a fish, Pisces.
I'd forgotten all about that one. I mean, hats off to them.
It's great. But you know, that's the nice thing about the show is we do so many different types of questions and things like that. And now we do have a bit more time to banter, just stuff like that. You know, it's just you can have fun with it. It's not if we were slick, you just have to go. No, I'm sorry, it's incorrect. It's Libra. Whereas we, of course, can now spend 5 minutes taking the mick out of them because we've got a bit of time, and hopefully people respond to that.
No, I think that's what makes it as well. You know, it's a great quiz. I love quizzes, and some of them work and some of them don't they? And then
that's definitely true.
But there's something about Pointless that makes it until you've been on it and lost, and then can't watch it for 3 months because you. It hurts you. Seriously.
When you're watching it now, yeah. Whenever a question comes up, do you just go, "Oh, geez, I know that."
Yeah.
Like every time.
Yeah. But it's like I picked up the book, which is what we're here to talk about.
Oh yeah. Yeah.
And the first two things, I just flicked quite and went, "Oh, you know." Yerevan for the European City, pointless answer. City Lights for Charlie Chaplin, pointless answer. I was going, why couldn't this book, why couldn't these have come
honestly,
up?
I'm so excited for you coming back and getting knocked out in the first round again, just to see. I mean, you're a genuinely lovely fellow, but yeah. Wouldn't that be just an, oh God, my can
wife,
you imagine?
My so wife said she would leave the country for the week, because I was the next day, I kind of coped quite well on the night, but on the next day I was...
Really? Yeah. A wreck?
I was just
until some celebs come back and back and back. Yeah. We've had people on 4 or 5 times now. I think people are beginning to notice. But you can just keep going until you win that trophy.
Okay. We've got friends of the show who can come back whenever they want.
Yeah, well, I get it. I'm just going to run up and in your face. Yes! It'll take me a long time. Hopefully Robert Webb will do a good job. With the book, there's questions and there's a few question and answers to you as well. Have you thought of doing a pointless tactics book?
Actually, it'd be quite short.
Well, I don't know, because I think there must be questions, there must be answers that are just quite good answers. I mean, like in geography, you've got Djibouti and Central African Republic that come up a lot. There must be quite a few, you know, films. I always think, like, The Player must be quite a good film, because loads of people are in it.
Yeah, loads of woolly animals. I mean, so in the book, it's our 100 favourite questions from Pointless over the years, and with all the answers and all that kind of stuff, so you can play along. But yeah, in between, we answer all the questions we're ever asked about Pointless, like what's on my computer, and you know, do you get one trophy each and all that kind of stuff. But you've done something about the best podium to be on and stuff like that, haven't you?
Yeah, podium four. Someone came running up to us yesterday. We were doing a book signing yesterday, and some guy came running up and said, I've got an idea for you. I think he thought he was going to be the guy who told the matchmakers to only put the striking side on one side, or you know, he said, round two, start at the other end. Start at the other end. Thank you. I've done this. And off he went. And we thought he'd run all the way to the city to find us in a bookshop to touch. It's not a bad idea, that, actually, because podium four is always the best podium to be on.
Right.
Always. What were you on?
A three.
Three.
Yeah.
Three, so it's pretty easy on three.
Yeah. Okay.
Well,
okay.
But then, you know, it's that tactics that Rona went wrong, so then it's coming back, and I had to get under seven to be sure of getting through. I should have just done a medium answer, really.
So the work, right, you think you had it bad.
Yeah.
So Lee Mack. Lee Mack comes on. We love Lee. And is a big fan of the show, and his kids are proper big fans of the show as well. So he decides to bring them up. It was a horrible, we're up at Elstree. It was a thunderstorm day, so it took him 3.5 hours to get there. Him and his wife come
and
up
he lives
with,
in Kingston,
with the two
so
kids.
Other end of, yeah. Other end of London.
So 3.5 hours it takes him to get there. He gets it literally just before the whole thing starts, and he's like, all right, come on, let's do it. And he, as a partner, he had Bobby Ball. Bobby Ball plays his dad in Not Going Out. Now, you know, I wouldn't have chosen Bobby Ball myself, but that is Lee's prerogative. That's who he's chosen. So 3.5 hours to get there. He's on podium one, Lee.
His kids are all there. There's a special dispensation to allow them in. Nooks normally have to be over 16. Right.
And we go, okay, lovely, have a little chat, blah, blah, blah. Okay, let's take a look at the first round. Right, the first, it's a words round. Nice round, especially for Lee. Easy for Lee, because he's a writer, all that stuff. So we go, okay, we're looking for words ending S-O-N. Okay, any word ending S-O-N. First person up is Bobby. Bobby's going first for that team. Lee's still catching his breath like that. Bobby has been there a while. He's looking pretty confident. He goes, words end S-O-N. Appleson. To which we look slightly uncomprehending. Lee looked
not even a name.
Furious. Furious. So it says Appleson. So we go, Xander, quite right, isn't it? That's the professional he is. Okay, Appleson, let's take a look, see if that's the right answer, and how many it scored gets 100 points. You then, of course, go all the way down the line. Everyone gets perfectly acceptable answers, because we can all think of words ending S-O-N. You come all the way back down. Lee is already knocked out. He's taken 3.5 hours to get there. He stood behind Bobby Ball saying Appleson. There's nothing he can do. Then 3.5 hours in the car home.
Did you find out what he thought Appleson meant?
We will never know.
We will never know.
Appleson.
Do you want an apple, son? That's what, yeah, it, apple, that's what it can be. Yes, Dad, I love one.
What on earth could it be? But, you know, he then wrote, Lee then wrote an entire episode of Not Going Out in this new series where he comes and plays Pointless.
Right.
I think just to make up for the disappointment.
And did he win in that? We probably can't say.
We'll find out. It's on soon. It's very funny, actually.
Talk about it. And so, who are the 100 people who answer these questions? Because that should be part of it. It goes, we've asked 100 people, and 70 of them are really stupid. So bear that in mind.
Who has anyone in this room ever been asked? No. Has anyone in this room ever met anyone or heard about anyone? Is a bit. Have you?
Oh, there we go. Proof
that you're the first person I've ever come across. They put it on Facebook.
It was just someone making up to show off. Yeah, I've been asked a question. Someone asked me a question.
Well, I'm one of the regular 100. Yes. It's all done online.
Right.
That's the thing. And it's a complete cross section of the British population. Because people will say, oh, this is nonsense. I can't believe no one knew any superbike winners. You go, well, people who know about superbikes know everything, but nobody knows about it.
Yeah.
You know, you can tell because we. It's very difficult coming up with questions for this show because you come up with like a list. You say, okay, let's find world superbike winners.
Yeah.
And you send the list off to your 100 and it comes back and everything is zero apart from like a couple which are one. And you think, well, you can't use that. You know, it's an unusable list. So there's all these questions you come up with and they're impossible because as soon as you poll them, either that all the answers are obvious or there's loads of answers that you don't know right down the bottom of the list or it's all zero.
Yeah.
We did Turner Prize winners once. And I think Grayson Perry scored 1 point.
Right.
And that was it. That was it. And no, everybody else scored zero.
Yeah.
So that we call that a jackpot round.
Yes. Yeah. But that's quite a good tactic, though, to go for the... If you know something a little bit about a subject like art or poetry, to go for that because people don't know about it generally.
That's a good one to go in our book the tips book.
Yeah.
But it's exactly right. You get couples and you'll say, okay, let's take a look at the three categories up here. We've got modern art... we've got 16th century poetry, or we've got film. And, you know, she'll say, well, of course I've got a degree in modern art, haven't I? But I don't really want it all to be on me. That would all be on me. And he'll go, yeah, well, I'm a professor of 16th century poetry, but that would all be on me when I really want to. So we both know a bit about film, don't we? Yeah. And then they go for film.
And they think film, because film sounds fun.
Yeah. Yeah.
And then it's, you know, if you don't happen to know every last thing that Kurt Russell made.
Well, it's sort of so annoying when you see someone get through to the last round and then they give the three most obvious answers first of an actor. You kind of go, at least just make something. I don't just say...
It was fun. Yesterday, which was Diane Keaton films.
Oh, yeah.
And they literally just went, we have never heard of Diane Keaton. And I think you sort of rubbed your hands together and go, oh, brilliant, this will be a fun few minutes.
Yeah. Oh, God. It's always hilarious when people have to make stuff up, though, and you get the lovely old couple, and, you know, it's songs by The Jam.
Yes.
And they go, oh, we don't know The Jam. So we're going to go, ooh, I love you.
Yes.
Ooh, I
flowers in my basket. And Tinky Donky Doo.
But you see, I bet you could look through all artists, and I bet most artists have a song called I Love You. So I Love You would be a good guess for any artist.
Yeah, it's not bad at all.
Not bad.
Or Love. Very occasionally, never in the final round, but very occasionally people guess an answer and get it right. We've had a couple, haven't we?
Yeah, we have actually. There was some really good. What was the James Brown one?
There was some film. It was Magnificent Seven or something like that. Yeah. And she didn't know anybody in the Magnificent Seven, so she just went, oh, James Brown. And of course, if you go on IMDb, you look down like right at the bottom of the list. There's some old 50s actor called Jimmy Brown, and you think, well, it's a correct answer, and obviously it's pointless.
Yes.
And then someone made up a politician as well, didn't they?
Yeah, again, it's always Brown. Nick Brown.
Nick Brown. They said, well, quite often they're just colours with like common words in front of them, aren't they? Which politicians are, if you think about it.
Yeah.
Brown, Nick Brown. And you think, he was agriculture minister under Tony Blair. That's a pointless answer. It's lovely when that happens.
Yeah.
I don't think anyone's ever done that in a jackpot round, so that's what we always want, isn't it?
It's going to happen.
Someone to make up a film or a book.
Yeah.
Oh, that would be lovely, wouldn't it?
Because when they make them up, they tend to go crazy. You know, they make up a crazy name. And it does make sense just to go for, let's go for just something.
Well, make something up that's fun. Yeah. I mean, sometimes they do. Sometimes they do.
It's hard, though. If you said, now, make up a Hilary Mantel novel, you just go, especially if you've got 60 seconds, it's almost impossible. Yeah.
The Fox Lodge. Oh, so
Fox
close.
Lodge.
You never know. You're very tall, Richard.
Yep.
Just thought I'd let you know.
Yeah, good. It's good.
Because sometimes you might not know.
No, I do. Yesterday, we were on the one show yesterday, weren't we? And just loads of text saying, are you really tall or are Theo Pafitis, Alexander Armstrong and Donny Osmond all really short? Okay, well, I don't know. Why don't you play the odds? Work out it might be me. They haven't booked a series of midgets. Yeah. It'd be great if in about 10 years' time I come out as 5 foot 10 and my whole on-screen career has been a piece of performance art about perspective.
Let's hope so. And the best thing about you, Alexander, is you are directly related to William the Conqueror. What do you think William the Conqueror would make of Pointless?
That's about time someone asked that.
All over. I think he'd love it. Yeah,
he'd be proud of you.
Yeah, I think he would. Yeah.
It'd be great to have him on, though, because by dint of his name, we'd go, you look, Conqueror, are you? You're a Conqueror. We shall see.
William the Conqueror.
We shall see. Yeah. And if he didn't get through to the final round, we'd be like, oh, brilliant. I call him the William the head-to-head loser.
And he was a bastard as well, was he? He was William the Bastard.
He was.
You would know. So presume you don't know who your next relation back was.
No,
he was,
no idea.
So his bastard.
That's a good point, actually.
Yeah. Or did you know that when you went on that?
No idea. No idea.
That's so cool, isn't it?
It was quite cool.
That is the.
It was quite cool. Everyone always says, "God, you just looked so smug when you found out." And I said, "I wasn't. I was trying my hardest not to look smug, but I was really quite pleased."
That's amazing. It's amazing.
But actually, statistically, I think everyone in this room is probably descended from.
To prove it.
Not so much as you, though. But you did a brilliant sketch in Armstrong and Miller, and by the way, they should bring Armstrong and Miller back. That's my opinion. You were on Who Do You Think You Are? And as far as I remember, they went through all of your relatives.
Every one of them was a whore. Yeah. And they went through, and just when I'm, every time it happens, it slightly wrong foots me. Just when I'm about to go, oh good, yeah, this is my cue to cry. They go, oh, but it gets better. Because a few years later in the census, look, brothel keeper. They've gone up in the world. And then I go, mate, I'm much more interested in my father's side of the family, actually. Yeah.
That's terrific. Cool. Well, in a minute we'll throw it open to... Is there any way you can give me the questions in advance for the next time I'm on, and then I can do a bit of revision?
That's it.
Just me, though.
As long as no one watches this and finds out.
Okay,
that's actually part of the plot to not going out, isn't it?
Oh, yeah, it is. A little bit. Bit of a spoiler.
That's a spoiler.
Nah, not really, no.
I mean, if Lee Mack goes on not going out... He goes on with Daisy as well.
Right.
He's going to cheat at some point. He tries to cheat. Oh, yeah. I can't. I'm going to say no more.
But in reality, you don't. Do you know the questions that are coming up?
I don't know the questions. The first time I see the questions is literally when I sit down at the desk. Because you do so, we do four a day. And, you know, you record them very quickly. And we literally go away, change suits, and come back. We've got like 10-minute break in between. So I turn up, and the question team, we work their socks off all day, every day. They'll bring on the first question, and they'll show me what the rest of the questions are. So it's the first time I ever see them, isn't it? So people will say, what are you writing down? And I think, well, I'm literally trying to get every single bit of information I can from this thing, trying to find, you know, work out what happens if they say this, what happens if they say that. So I'm usually panicking at any given time. It's quite scary, isn't it?
You don't know them at all.
I don't know them.
But that's
because people always say to me, is Zander really that clever, or does someone tell him the answers?
No, I only give the answers when I know them. It's very clever. Otherwise, I say nothing.
I just say that in the book, again, someone, I think I mentioned that, and I say, because he is genuinely very, very good. Genuinely, if I had to go on Pointless, and I had a choice of Zander or Bobby Ball as my partner, I would...
You go for me.
And Bobby Ball wasn't available. I would, I would definitely go for Zander, but I say in the book, occasionally, because I love, you know, I'll usually get Zander to talk through the board if one of the contestants doesn't want to, and you're very good, very good. But sometimes the board will be up there and there'll be like four spaces left. And I'll be like, and he won't make eye contact. He'll be like, or they're all like looking away. Like that thing, old Zander doesn't want to go through the board today. I see that, so then I don't ask
him. Do you know something really weird that started happening at the end of the last run that we were recording? Every time we had a words round, Richard would write down what he thought my word would be at the end of the round, because I always like to play along in a words round. I'm funny like that. I love a words round.
I like a words round.
So Richard always writes it down, then hides the piece of paper. And at the end of the round, and I always then try and change what I had just to confound him. And then when I say my word, Richard always gets the paper, and it's the blooming word he's written down.
He's got 100 pieces of paper.
No, I haven't realised it. But I don't think any of those have gone out yet, have they?
Have they not?
And
yet,
I think
no.
I did it like four times in a row.
Yeah, it was quite spooky.
It was really spooky. It was
we spend a lot of time
it was freaking
together,
me out.
Yeah, but I think
we may spend a little bit too much time in each other's company.
Yeah, probably.
Yeah. I'm looking, so you're coming on with Robert Webb.
I think so. Well, I mean, you know, these things change.
That's fun, because my favourite thing on Pointless, my absolute favourite thing is talking about Armstrong and Miller.
Yes.
So I so love to
three
talk
about Liam Harry.
So yeah. I love to talk about Ben and how talented he is. Yeah. And any other, like Mitchell and Webb, Lee and Herring, I'm very happy to say how brilliant they are. Because usually the line is because they got two really, really strong performers and two really charming performers. So we'll be doing a lot of that.
Good, I look forward to that.
That'd be great.
So let's throw it open to anyone got any questions, and we'll wait for the microphone to get you. Oh, yeah, we'll pass the mic down again to, this is a bit easier though. Hello.
Hello, hi.
Hello.
It's close. So we were talking about Mastermind earlier. If both of you were to go on Mastermind, what would your specialist subjects be?
Ooh, Tintin.
Would Tintin? It?
Yeah, Tintin.
Really?
Yeah.
God,
good
you sound
Tintin.
Like you thought about that.
Literally, while she was saying it, I thought Tintin.
Okay.
I don't know
who wrote Tintin. Who wrote Tintin?
Georges Remy.
Okay. Yeah, good. 1 point.
Hey!
Oh, thank God for that. I don't know what I would do. Because we wouldn't be allowed to do Pointless, would we?
Football. You do Fulham.
Fulham Football Club. I might do something like The Simpsons. I might do Brit
Darts.
Britpop would be quite good. Oh, darts would be good, wouldn't it? But you know, you don't want to leave that show and people go, oh God, he knows a lot about darts. You know, that's not what was your specialist subject?
I did Rasputin.
Did you? That's
but I
cool.
was writing about him quite a lot, but then I realised I didn't actually know any of the facts, and I don't speak Russian. And so I had to. I took 2 weeks to learn all the names phonetically.
How did you do?
I did very well. I got the highest ever weight, though, because this is why I'm sort of doomed to failure. I got the highest ever score on Celebrity Mastermind
for
2 minutes,
and then
Hilary Mantle got not Hilary Mantle, Hilary Kay from Antiques Roadshow, who did. Antiques as her specialist subject in Wedgwood. Did Wedgwood as her specialist subject. Got one more point than I did. So
you're kidding me.
So it was just, yeah.
But you
so I was hoping I'd go on Pointless. At least I would get a point. Surely I'd get a Pointless trophy.
But you know what? We had Trevor and Simon the other day. The first time they came, because they were desperate to win, weren't they?
Especially
Simon. And they're absolutely lovely. And the first time they came on, absolutely crashed and burned.
Yeah.
And then they were on this weekend and they walked away with a jackpot. So, you know, dreams can come true.
Let's hope so. Yeah. That'd be a minute. If I do that, I'll just retire. I won't do anything from TV quizzes, maybe. I don't get asked on too much. Anyway, that's a good question. Any other questions? Lady Bone, you can pass that back. Hello.
As questions for Richard, I was just wondering, what's the first TV show you ever pitched to like a big channel, and how did you get your foot in the door?
Oh, that's a good question. Well, I got my foot in the door because I'd done a little bit of sports writing, and there was an advert in The Guardian, literally when I just left university, saying researchers wanted for a computer games television program, and I knew nothing about computer games other than I'd just written an article about football computer games. I'd literally just done it, and I thought, well, that's enough, surely. So I got an interview with these people. I went in, and it was a terrible, terrible, terrible place. And they were desperate for people to work for no money. And that was back in the days, of course, when if you moved to London, you got housing benefit and all that kind of stuff. And also, you didn't have any debts because I got a full grant and all those things. So I could work for no money for 6 months, which you can't do these days, which is that's a bigger issue. Anyway, so I went there, worked there for 6 months, met enough people and started pitching things. And the first big show I came up with was a show called Survivor, which it's a huge show in the States, the most profitable show in the history of the world. And I own 0% of it.
Oh, no.
Yeah, there it is. It can't be helped. I've done all right. I'm okay. But that was the first thing. But yeah, literally, it was just getting lucky and getting in the door. So I didn't have any contacts or anything. And then once you're in telly, it's easy to stay in telly. Because if you're good, people hold on to you. They're absolutely desperate to hold on to you.
If you've created Survivor, they're going to go, should we keep that bloke on in case he has another
and
idea?
And cheap.
It's an opposite.
It's weird, that, isn't it?
Yeah. And what do you think is the secret of a great quiz show? What is it?
A quiz. I mean, quizzes are hard. The secret of quizzes is play them over and over and over again. Have a big hook, like a big central idea. But the mechanics of it, we as I said, we're Million Pound Drop. We literally play it hundreds and hundreds of times. And one of the keys, the real key on pitching a quiz or inventing a quiz show, is play it. There's two ways you can break a format. Play it with unbelievably clever people who know the answer to everything. And if your format stands up to that, then it's good. If you can do a show and it's still entertaining when everyone knows everything, and then play it with people who literally know nothing at all and see if your format still works. And if it works in both those scenarios, you can do 800 of them because it's never going to break.
Yeah.
So that's what we do. We play it, and then play it with really, really good people, and then play it with really, really bad people. And the best thing, you know, because Endemol's a big company, and the bad people know that they're the bad people now. So they kind of go, oh, so yeah, we can. It's interesting you're asking me to do a run through of this thing. Yeah, I can probably make it.
Is this the same show that I just saw Stephen Fry and Stephen Hawking coming out the door for? All right.
But it's more than most other shows. It's quite hard work because documentaries, you can have an idea, you can go off and do it. Quiz shows, they've got to work from start to finish. If we've got one moving part that doesn't work, then it will fail.
And do you know when you've got come up with something, you think this one's definitely going to be a massive hit, or does it?
You never know. I mean,
I was convinced Pointless was going to be a massive, but I'm convinced everything's going to be massive. I thought Prize Island was going to be a massive hit.
It's fun though, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was great. Nothing wrong with that.
No, I mean, you genuinely don't. The only show that I was convinced from the pilot was going to be a huge hit was Deal or No Deal.
Yeah.
The second I saw it, the second you play it, I just thought, you know what, people are going to love this, and you know, that was huge. But with this, I remember explaining to Xander in the first series, because Xander said, well, this is the sort of show, if it does well, you could do like kind of 100 of them. And I said, Xander, you're so naive. So naive. I'm a professional producer, Xander. I know what I'm talking about. And I said, no, that happens very, very rarely. You might do another 30 if it goes all right, and then that'll probably be it. And then the next series, you go, oh, but if this goes, we might even do 150. And you think, Xander, you fool. And then 800 shows later, it turns out he was roughly right. Although I'm still a pessimist.
You don't think we're going to make it to 1,000, do you?
You never know. Yeah, well, they just commissioned another 200. So
it could get,
the only way to not get to 1,000 is if one of us were to pass away.
If you do and four
then,
a day.
Even you, then.
You could just get Sue Barker in for me.
Yeah.
Oh, God, she'd be so much better as well.
Well,
Yeah.
If you're doing four a day, you could just do them for the next 10 years, four a day, and then after you have died, there'll still be loads to come out.
That's the thing.
It could go on for hundreds of years.
Well, that's the thing. If you make Teletubbies or something like that, is once you know once they've got 200 of them, you know the kids have been replaced every couple of years. they don't need to make any more. You know, we still need to make a few more. They show too many repeats.
That's true. That's true.
It'd be quite annoying to watch it in 2145 and go up to May 2012. Who was the best golfer? And any more questions? So let's get this gentleman here, just because he's hard to get to.
Hi, my name's Twan.
Twan?
Twan.
Twan.
Great name.
Thank you.
Like Antoine?
Yes.
Twan.
You're the first person who's picked up on that.
There you go.
Pointless answer. There's a lot of shows at the moment starring celebrities, as opposed to like with Pointless, where you have celebrity specials. Do you think that's because their format's pap?
Interesting.
I personally don't. I think just there's more choice these days. And something like Family Fortunes, you know, if you put on a regular version of that, it would probably get you 3 million. If you put on a celebrity version, the fact is it will get you 4.5 million, and it doesn't really cost you any more. So, you know, if you're ITV, that's sort of what you're going to do. Some shows, Pointless, Chase, various other shows, you can absolutely, if it's a good format, you can do stuff. But there's some of the things they're bringing back, Celebrity Squares and what have you, I think it's safer for them to have them with celebrities. And I think if they brought back a regular one, I think it would be, even though Family Fortunes is the greatest format of all time, in my humble opinion, there's too many celebrity quiz shows now. Though. That's the truth.
I guess it is. Do you prefer the celebrity or the weekday ones that we do?
Watching or filming?
Filming.
Well, actually, the answer is the same for both, which is the regular ones.
I think it is the regular ones, for the simple reason actually that I think people are much less nervous actually, weirdly, on the regular ones. Celebrities, as we were saying before, can be really, really nervous, can't they, Richard?
Yeah, I was really nervous. I never get nervous.
The atmosphere is much really more charged, honestly. So people muck about more on the regular ones.
And when it takes twice as long to record the celebrity ones,
because they muck about.
Because they muck about.
Never shut up.
And they try and cheat all the time, literally all the time. Yeah. It's extraordinary, isn't it?
Yeah.
You didn't. You were very good.
No, we were very good.
But they had Ulrika on. She literally. She it was like a wall of sound. Up, wasn't it?
Sometimes you have to say, like, I'm so sorry, because we got earpieces. We can hear every single thing people are saying. So whenever people cheat, we can hear it. I mean, that's why we got them. But, you know, so I'll be sort of going through some sort of thing about bloody lakes in Africa or something, and all I can hear is Ulrika talking about going to the hairdressers to Jet from Gladiators. And you think this is... It's hard for me to focus, A, because I've got this voice, and B, it's actually quite an interesting conversation.
And it's Jet from Gladiators.
Jet was
That was amazing. Yeah. Actually, that's when I prefer the celebrity ones, because we don't get Jet from Gladiators on the regular ones, do we?
No.
We would do if it was up to me.
And also, celebrity squares without celebrities in it would just be squares.
Oh, that's
that
a good point.
That wouldn't be very good.
No.
That is
might
a good
be
point.
Better for me. It's the
but, you know, pointless celebrities on a genuine Saturday night, with respect to both of us, it's the cheapest primetime Saturday night show in the history of the BBC. It's a tenth of the cost of The Chase. A tenth of the cost. It's unbelievably cost-effective for the ratings it gets, unfortunately. So, you know, it's... Why wouldn't you commission loads of them? It's the truth, because you know people like them, people enjoy them. Hopefully, it's fun. Hopefully, it's funny, and it gets an audience that wouldn't tune into a regular one on a Saturday night. But unbelievably for TV, low cost. God damn it!
Do you get fed up of people making the joke about in pointless celebrities saying, "Oh yeah, it should be called pointless celebrities because they are
when we first
pointless
started,
celebrities."
No one ever told the celebrities that that's what it was called.
Right, okay.
And so when I said, "And let's meet today, it's pointless celebrities," you, Edwina Curry going.
That is so true. Now you're still on Twitter endlessly, but you get people going, "That's quite an ironic title." You think, "Yeah, you know, we sort of thought it through when we, we're all playing the game here. It's okay. It had occurred to us."
Yes.
But that was the beauty of coming up with the name Pointless right from the start of this.
Yeah.
We'd endlessly say we got a pointless development meeting, then we say we got a pointless pitch meeting at the BBC, a pointless budget meeting. It's lovely. It's a gift that keeps on giving, isn't it?
Yeah.
And you still laugh every time just as much, because you've got mentally.
You still get you still get tweets now, and literally someone will say, "That's a bit of a pointless tweet," or "Isn't that a bit pointless?"
Yeah.
And you think, I've been on Twitter for 5 years now. It's just have a little think about whether I've heard it before.
I like when Lord Alan Sugar, who I'm quite obsessed with on Twitter, obviously everyone keeps on going, "You're fired," but he will then retweet it and go, "You muppet, you're the first person." But that's what makes it enjoyable, that he will respond. So I'm sure most people do it just because they know it makes him really angry.
He does get angry beautifully, doesn't he? It's like a wasp in a bottle.
It's great. Pass the mic down to this gentleman here.
I was just wondering about syndication, whether you internationally syndicate Pointless, and if so, do you stipulate that there should be a very tall man behind a desk with a switched off laptop?
It's a good idea. You know, funnily enough, because we sell a lot of our shows abroad. So £1 million drop is sold everywhere. It's very profitable and stuff. Pointless is a show that hasn't really travelled. And I think because as soon as you send it's so British. It's so British. And you've got these two buffoons hosting it. And as you say, a tall guy with a laptop that's clearly not switched on at any point. And I think foreign buyers kind of go, I see the ratings. I'm impressed with those. That all looks good. I cannot begin to imagine how we make this in our country. So we do it in a few places, Germany, France, a few European territories. But it hasn't travelled as much as most shows, and I think it's our fault.
Oh, is it our fault? I knew we'd come into it somewhere, yes. But they've got, in Croatia, they just have one presenter. She's very beautiful.
Oh,
I don't know which one of us she is. Is she both?
You, I think. The French came over and did their pilot on our set. And the French, you, was a very nice fellow. I saw him on Eurovision Song Contest a couple of years later,
really?
Doing some hosting. And the French, me, the single most beautiful 40-year-old woman you've ever seen in your life. I mean, absolutely extraordinary and lovely as well. And you could just see the crew for the next 3 or 4 days just looking at me going, "What the hell? What are you doing here? What are you doing?" She was lovely.
Yeah.
I did say, if you need any tips, I don't know if you need tips, we should just go out for dinner, for goodness sake. Just tell you some stuff about how I do the job, I don't know if it would be helpful. She said, no.
Shall we have one more question? Oh, I saw you first at the back, so this gentleman in the middle at the back, if we can pass one of the mics out, there's one going to.
Hi guys, do you have a wish list for pointless celebrities? Like someone you'd love to have on the show?
Actually, a lot of celebrities, we hear from people that celebrities like. Daniel Radcliffe is a massive fan of the show, apparently.
Yes, he wants to come on.
But the trouble is, every time, if you go through his agents don't even send the email on to him. They go, no, no, no. Judi Dench, apparently, a big fan of the show.
I want to get to two people who both properly are fans of the show. Neither of them will come on because I wouldn't go on Celebrity Mastermind because I've got all that's going to happen is either I win, everyone goes, or I lose, and people go, but hold on. So I would never do it. So Stephen Fry and Victoria Wood both said, oh, yeah, we love it. Yeah, it's what a lovely show. And you ask, how many do you do a day and this kind of stuff? And you kind of go, well, you could come on if you want. But I don't think this. But that would be my dream pairing, I think, Stephen Fry and Victoria Wood.
Were we thinking we might, if we were ever to be contestants, we thought we might get them to host. Victoria could do my job and Stephen could do yours.
Oh, that's a good idea, isn't it?
Good idea.
No, they'd be a bit too good.
I'm a bit worried about that. Exactly.
I think maybe we should get the Chocolate Brothers.
Yeah. Well, hang on, they might be too good as well.
I'll tell you what, we'll get Bobby Ball to do both parts.
Bobby Ball and Appleson, his friend.
Bobby Ball, and he's allowed to say whatever he thinks the answer is. Yeah.
No, hold on. That's a great show. Yeah.
Let's do it. Well, I think that'll do us for now. So give a massive round of applause to Isaac Armstrong, Richard Osman.
Thank you very much indeed.